In this video, I'm going to be revealing my first winning dropshipping product and how I was able to generate multiple six figures in revenue with it. What's going on, guys? Yash here. Welcome back to the channel. I hope each and every single one of you guys is absolutely having a great week and a great day. Thank you guys so much for tuning in to another video. Before we do move forward, please do make sure to drop a huge like on this video and make sure you guys are subscribed with your post notification bell turned on. Absolutely smash that subscribe button. It would absolutely mean the world to me. So I decided to be completely open and transparent in this video and reveal my first winning dropshipping product to you guys. A lot of you guys may be just starting out, beginners. You guys may be curious as to what that kind of journey looks like, what kind of goes into a potential six-figure winning product. So I decided to actually make a video about it, breaking each and every aspect of this product down for you guys. Now, for those of you guys that don't know me, my name is Yash. How's it going? I've been into the e-commerce, dropshipping, and digital marketing space for a little over 2.5 years now, so I definitely want to shed some light and some value to you guys. You guys can take away that and apply it onto your own stores and into your own dropshipping journeys as well. Before we do move forward into the video, guys, if you guys already haven't, please do join my free Facebook group, Ecom Masterminds. I will be leaving a link to that in the description below with all my other social media channels as well. And with that being said, let's jump straight into the video. You definitely want to stay tuned for the entire video. So the foundation and the groundwork, right? So I want to give you guys a little bit of background info so you guys are up to date with myself. I actually started dropshipping about 2.5 years ago, right? And it wasn't until 2018 fall till I actually found my first six-figure winning product. And now this was about my sixth or seventh product that I was testing, okay? So again, it was in 2018 fall, just ending of Q3, going on to Q4. I believe it was around the beginning of October. The store I had was a general niche store in the outdoor space, okay? And previously, I actually had a Brooklyn theme, which is a free theme. Now, I am a big believer of utilizing professional paid themes just because they're so much more customizable. They come preloaded with a lot of apps and widgets. They just look more professional in general, and there's just so much you can actually do with a paid theme. So I actually took a step back and I transitioned my store into utilizing a professional paid theme, which was actually the booster theme. The booster theme is actually one of my favorite themes to utilize for a niche store or even a one product store. This store in particular, again, was in the outdoor space, and it had three categories, right? Each category actually had 5 to 7 products. These 5 to 7 products were actually acting as filler products, right? For social proof. Obviously, a knit store isn't going to have only 2 or 3 products on it. It's going to have dozens and multiple products on it. So to look legitimate, again, for that social proof aspect, I had 3 categories in that outdoor space, and I had 5 to 7 products in each individual category. Furthermore, I had a well-put-together Instagram page and also a well-put-together Facebook page. I was consistently posting on both of them, and I was pretty much active on a day-to-day basis, right? I was engaging, I was liking, commenting, sharing, DMing, really the whole nine yards to really ensure that my social media is as up to par as possible and they look professional and trustworthy. I'm a big believer of doing something the right way from the get-go if you're going to do it at all. So I really make sure I give importance to each and every single component, whether it be back-end or front-end on my dropshipping business. And if you can get a drum roll, my product was the ponytail beanie. Now, if you guys have been in the space for some while now, you may or may not have actually seen this product. And this product actually did really, really well in 2019 as well, okay? So what the ponytail beanie basically is it's basically a hat, right? And basically, it has a hole right here. So women with long hair can actually, you know, pull their hair out without it getting messy. So it's nice and stylish, it was very trendy, and it really caught my eye right from the get-go. The cost price for this particular product was about $3.50. Shipping price was about $2. That's when ePacket was much, much, much cheaper. At the time of this video, we're currently dealing with the COVID-19 pandemic, so ePacket is completely through the roof, okay? So again, back then it was only $2. Usually ePacket is between $1 to $2.50. My total cost price was about $5.50, and the selling price was about $14.95. So I had marked it 3x more, okay? That's kind of my rule of thumb. I usually look for products that I can mark up at least 2.5 to 3x. I actually could have sold this product for $19.95. I saw a lot of other stores, once I started scaling, selling at a much higher price, but I just kind of was afraid. You know, I didn't want to risk anything, so I just kept it at $14.95. And what I also noticed for this specific product is that most people were buying two. I was selling like 7 or 8 different colors of this specific ponytail beanie as well. If you direct your attention to the right now, how I found this product, right? So if you guys actually want to take a look at my entire product research and validation strategy, if you click on that video right there, it should take you to that video where I actually walk you guys through on how I find potential 6- and 7-figure winning products. And I actually have the same strategy, which I actually carried over, which I use right now. So first and foremost, what I was doing prior to when I found this winning product was I went onto Facebook search bar and I basically typed in different keywords. Words, right? 50% off, free shipping, buy one get one free, or BOGO free. I was typing these different keywords because more than likely a lot of dropshippers utilize these keywords into their ads. So I was basically finding for products that were already doing really, really well that had really good engagement with it. Second of all, I used a Google Chrome extension called Unicorn Smasher. What it basically does is if you actually go to Amazon and if you type in a keyword such as beanie or winter products, that extension basically lets you sort all the top ranking products by revenue. So during that period, I actually saw that this product, I searched different keywords, was coming up 2 to 4, right? The top 2 to 4 highest product marked by revenue. So that was a good indicator right there. Thirdly, I went to this website called eBay Watch Counter. Basically lets you do a free audit of all the people, you know, eyeing or spying on this specific product. Again, for that, I was using different keywords and whatnot. So again, not only was I researching, I was also cross-validating as well, right? You never only depend on one metric or one resource or one platform to go ahead and go test that product. You always want to do your complete due diligence. Next, I was also observing Instagram pages, right? This is something I do till this day. I was basically typing in different keywords and different hashtags in the search bar to see kind of what other pages were promoting, right? What other influencers were promoting on their stories and on their feeds. So a few hours a day, that's something I was doing back then. It's something I still do on a day-to-day basis. Product research and validation is something that should be ongoing, even if you have something working already. And lastly, I went to Google Trends. Google Trends is very powerful. I basically went to the past 90 days in the US and I filtered by the shopping intention, right? And basically, I saw the bar going up above 50. You want that above 50 for like the past 90 days, or at least going above 50. So I saw that a lot of people were, you know, eyeing this specific product, and a lot of people were searching for different beanies and just, you know, winter apparel for women as well. So that was a good indicator right there as well. So once I validated this product, came the game plan of this product, right? Now to backtrack again, guys, my bread and butter were Instagram influencers. That's how I began my marketing journey into dropshipping, right? Instagram influencers are great for quick return of investment. If you actually want to see how I find profitable Instagram influencers, you can click on that video right there as well. I wanted to basically test this product on influencers or through influencers, and I wanted to establish that proof of concept because this was something I was already really, really, really good at, okay? So what I did was I found one personal influencer and 2 niche pages. The personal influencer had about 350,000 followers. I paid that specific influencer $200 for a 24-hour story post with swipe up and also a feed post as well. So meaning the story post with swipe up and the feed post were gonna be up for 24 hours. The revenue I made from that was about $1,475 And I basically profited over $800, which was absolutely insane. Now, for this personal influencer, just for a quick note, for those of you guys that are new, personal influencers are basically influencers with a personal brand. So I actually shipped out multiple colors of this product to that specific influencer, and that influencer basically made a video and a whole different collage of the specific product actually wearing it, right? Human perception is very, very, very powerful, and it's very important as well. You know, if I, as a woman, saw this influencer wearing something like this, you know, it would instantaneously kind of boost that authoritative power. Next, the two niche pages. One niche page was about 250,000 followers. The other one was a little over 450,000 followers, right? For the first one with 250,000 followers, I paid $95 for a 24-hour story post with swipe up plus feed post. So again, the story post with swipe up and the feed post were gonna be up for 24 hours. I generated $540 in revenue, and out of that, I kept $220 in profit. Notice how this is such a quick return of investment if you have the right product, if you have the right landing page, if you have the right offer, and if you have the right influencer with the proper audience. Second influencer, the one with 450,000 followers, I did a 12-hour story post with swipe up plus 12-hour feed post plus a 12-hour link in bio as well, where they actually have the link to my store in their bio. With this influencer, I generated $610 and profited over $230. So over the 5 days, I basically profited $1,265. And I said over 5 days because basically this first influencer I had on day one, then day three, and then day five. Now, when it comes to influencer marketing, I've gotten pretty good at it. So what I do, especially on bigger e-commerce days such as Black Friday, Cyber Monday, I actually stack different influencers. So basically what I would have done is instead of having these three spread over the 5 days, I would basically have them throughout the same day. So again, $1,265 profit over 5 days was absolutely amazing. I knew that people were liking this product. Women were finding this product really, really useful and really cool and neat, right? So again, this established my proof of concept, and now I figured that I was able to transition, or I should transition, over to Facebook to get that consistency and also to get that scalability for this product as well. So now we came to Facebook ads, okay? So what I basically did was I had a brand new ad account, okay? Obviously, I was testing other products on this same ad account, on this same general niche store before, but I really didn't get much traffic. I probably spent like only probably $1,000 to $2,000. So I considered still it a brand new ad account, new Facebook business page, and new pixel. Now, I have an asterisk over the pixel because the pixel wasn't really that nurtured. It really wasn't that seasoned. But now with the influencers, it really registered so many events of people viewing my website, people adding to cart, initiating checkout, adding payment info, let alone purchases, right? So now my pixel was a little bit seasoned and trained as well. So what I basically did was I started off with one conversion campaign with 10 different ad sets. Each ad set had a different interest or multiple interests. Some ad sets were stacked interests with 2 to 5 interests if the audience size was a little bit low at $7 a day. Back then, CBO, campaign budget optimization, wasn't really a thing. So I basically was still using ad set budgets. And I also optimized the pixel for purchase as well. That's really what I do always, even when I'm retargeting. The potential reach or audience size for each ad set was about 5 to 50 million. If it's a little over now, by the way, that's okay, but it was about 5 to 50 million. So going back to some of the ad sets that consisted of stacked interest, so let's say an interest is really, really good, but it's just under that 5 million threshold. I'll basically add other interests in that same ad set, interests that are very alike or similar to kind of get it between that 5 to 50 million. A good example is like LA Fitness. Okay, let's say LA Fitness gym was like 3 million. I would add Crunch Fitness, Planet Fitness, because those are very similar and alike interests to kind of get it to 5 to 50 million. So again, most of my ad sets were single interest. However, some of them did contain multiple or stacked interests. In terms of countries, I only started with the big three out of the big five: United States, Canada, and United Kingdom. It's because Australia and New Zealand, which are also part of the Big Five, you know, weren't really into that season of winter, right? October, November, December is kind of when it starts getting really, really warm in those countries, right? So again, this is very important to keep in mind, using your market intuition and your logic before you just go out and market to every single country. I knew that in North America, which is the US and Canada, it was already starting to get cold, and the United Kingdom was, you know, also starting to get colder. I think they were already within their season of winter. So overall, my timing of this product was very, very good as well, because in North America and the UK, October is just when it starts to become cold as well. And it's just when people start buying winter apparel and winter clothing and stuff like that too. So it was right at that perfect time frame. In terms of age, I kept it 16 to 65 plus. I left it alone. Gender, I was only targeting women, not men. Obviously, this is something for only women. The other good thing is women-based products are a little bit easier to sell because women are aggressive buyers by nature when it comes to online shopping. I know like all my friends who are girls, even my mother herself, you know, they love to shop online. So I was already out of favor when it came to the gender I was targeting because of the nature of the product. Placements, Facebook feed, and Instagram story. I know a lot of people say to do automatic placements, but even if I do automatic placements, I'll basically get a few lucky sales like the first few days, but I'll see that most of my traffic and most of my traction will always be from Facebook feed, and Instagram story. So that's what I kept it to. And now for the creatives, I was testing three different creatives, right? A video ad with a thumbnail, a carousel ad, and a single image ad. I was testing all different kinds of creatives because this product, guys, is pretty self-explanatory, right? It doesn't need a lot of unfolding. It doesn't need a lot of demonstration as well. So the single image ad and the carousel ad were working absolutely amazing as well. The single image ad basically consisted of like a nice collage of all the different colors. The carousel ad basically had like 7 or 8 different pictures of women wearing it in different colors. The video ad consisted of women basically trying on the hat, you know, making it seen or making it obvious how, you know, there's a hole in the back and they can actually pull their hair from the back. So I believe the video ad and the carousel ad were the ads that were performing really, really good. And the call to action I used was shop now. I also want to give you guys the actual ad copy I was using too, okay? Now keep in mind for the carousel ad, the ad copy was a little bit different. However, for the video ad with the thumbnail and the single image ad, I was using this exact same ad copy, okay? So for the primary text on the top, I had my hook, right? My main hook that will kind of reel people in initially to read the rest of the text and to watch the rest of the video as well. So I had as my hook, the first sentence, check out our super comfy and stylish ponytail beanies with a hard eye emoji. I don't really like to use too many emojis, only emojis that are relevant and that keeps it professional. As you can see, I only have 3 emojis. And again, it's because they are relevant and they basically enhance emotion as well, right? This was strictly a passion product and also, I guess, a little bit of a conveniency product as well, right? Because women didn't have to get their hair messy and stuff like that, and they can still stay warm at the same time. My second line was, these soft knit ponytail beanies are absolutely perfect for anyone with long hair to stay warm yet stylish. So it's saying that you can stay warm with this and you can stay stylish with this beanie as well, right? And it's also saying that anyone with long hair will really benefit from this specific beanie. So it's making it very, very obvious that, hey, if I'm a woman and I want to stay stylish and also warm in the winter and I have long hair, then I should definitely, definitely buy this beanie, okay? You want to make it very obvious. Then I basically use like a little trick. You can actually use these on your ad copy as well, depending on the product, if it fits in. I have tagged somebody who would like these this season with like a little snowflake emoji, right? So as people tag other people, more people will see it, more people will come to the ad, which is almost basically free traffic, right? I'm basically reaching other people even without actually targeting them or paying for those specific people seeing for the ad, because other people who are actually being targeted and seeing the ad are calling other people into the ad, okay? And this will also subsequently increase the engagement of the ad as well, which Facebook likes, and that will basically push my ad out to a higher quality of traffic as well. So it's like a win-win situation. And at the bottom, I have get yours here at 30% off with the store link. My headline was perfect to stay warm. I added like two or three extra R's just to make it like nice and witty and friendly. Remember, you're speaking to another human. That's what a lot of people get when they're writing their ad copy. You're speaking to another human. So be personal, be fun, especially with a product like this. In the description right below that, I had some urgency and scarcity. Not sold in stores, limited time only. So this ad copy worked very, very, very well when I was first setting up all my ads. What I did after was I basically let this run for about 2 days, 48 hours. Okay, what I did after the 48 hours was I cut back on any ad set, or I turned off any ad set that had a cost per click or CPC over $1.50, and any ad set that got no add to cart, no initiate checkout, and no purchase as well. Furthermore, I narrowed on the creative as well, right? So I had 10 ad sets. Each ad set was basically distributing to three different creatives, right? So let's say we have ad set A, it was going to the video, it was going to the carousel, and it was also going to the single image ad as well. So I basically cut back on the single image ad, and I kept the video ad and the carousel ad because I found that those were getting more link clicks, those were getting more watch time, and those were getting most of the add to carts, initiate checkouts, and purchases as well. What you can actually do is, if you're testing multiple creatives from the get-go, which you definitely should, you can actually save the creatives that aren't getting as much traction later on for lookalikes and for retargeting as well. So that's exactly what I did. I saved the single image ad later on for retargeting. So to fast forward things, these were my Facebook ads results. These were the actual breakdown of my Facebook ads. I ran this product till the beginning of February because that's when kind of is the core of winter, right? From March and onwards, the regions I was targeting, it starts getting a little bit warmer and warmer, and more than likely, people have already done their winter shopping by February as well. So after February, I started to get a little bit unprofitable. You know, my ads weren't getting as traction, and I eventually turned the whole product off by the second week of February. The total sales slash revenue for this product was about $301,000. As you can see, $282,186.48 came from Facebook ads alone. The rest came from email and SMS marketing, which I had backend system set up for. I was using Klaviyo and also SMS Bump as well. And from that, the revenue was $18,919. And you can see, guys, that your backend is so important to get that revenue in as well. So don't forget to set up your abandoned cart email sequences and your SMS marketing sequences as well. My total Facebook ads cost was about $138,000, as you can see right here. My cost of goods sold cost me $105,762. Transactional fees through Shopify payments / Stripe and PayPal were $8,850. I did have a few refunds, $560. Why? Because you cannot make everybody happy. That's just how it is. And my total profit was $48,050, which yielded in about a 16% profit margins. I don't consider that as great profit margins. You definitely want to try to get between the 20 to 35% mark. But for my first winning product, I think I did pretty decent and I was pretty satisfied as to what my results came out to be. So what I learned and what I also wish I had done a little bit differently when it came to this product and going onwards as well. First and foremost, patience, right? You have to give Facebook time to optimize, guys. I remember with this product, I was not profitable till like the second week. I was breaking even. I was even in the negative mark for like the first 10 or 11 days, which is completely okay. People don't realize that you need to give time for Facebook to actually find your potential audience. I had someone come up to me like just 3 days ago on my Facebook DMs and they said like, hey, I spent $70 and only got one sale. Like, what should I do? You know? So again, you need to give Facebook a little bit more time, especially if you have a new ad account and a new pixel. Patience is a virtue in this game. Second of all, any product or your product must have some kind of wow factor enabled into it, right? Whether it be a passion product or a problem solving and conveniency product, right? On top of that, after you find that product with the wow factor, you definitely want to test different creatives to give that flexibility on your end, right? If I had just tested, for example, a single image ad, which didn't perform as well when I was first starting out, and I didn't test those carousel ads, and I didn't test that video ad, that would have potentially limited the potential of this product, right? It would have hindered it. So you definitely want to test multiple creatives. You don't know what's going to work well, guys, okay? Never assume. You always want to let the data do the talking. Third, inconsistencies are absolutely normal, guys, when it comes to Facebook ads or any sort of paid digital media. So be prepared for them, right? That's why you really, really, really want to double down on your back end. You want to have, pre and post checkout upsells. You want to have email marketing systems in place, SMS marketing systems in place for the bad days that Facebook will bring you in terms of revenue. No day will exactly be the same. Even right now, many of my stores have a few bad days. Again, that's just how any sort of paid marketing platform really is. And last but not least, judge your ads. When I say ads, the metrics and KPIs and data points based on days of two and three. You never want to make a decision based off of only one day. That goes back to my previous point that not every day is going to be the same, guys. Okay, so you always, always, always want to judge, scale, cut back, whatever you're going to really do with your ads in days of two and three in terms of analyzing them. What I had done a little bit differently was I actually didn't add pre-checkout upsells, which is something I really, really preach right now to increase my AOV, right? Pre-checkout upsells are items or lower ticket items than your actual product that you're selling that go hand in hand with the actual product, right? That actually resonate with the central product. For example, if you're gonna go to the Apple Store and buy an iPhone 11 today, they're probably gonna pre-checkout upsell you not an iPad or not an iMac, but probably a wireless charging dock or a screen protector or a tempered glass or a iPhone case or something like that, right? So again, lower ticket items that go hand in hand or resonate with the main item that will increase your AOV. You want to try to squeeze as much out of your customer as much as possible. So I really, really, really wish I had done that. And second of all, add post checkout upsells as well. So after someone purchases, basically on the confirmation page, it basically puts three to five products in front of them to purchase as well. That can also increase your AOV. Nonetheless, I do still think that pre-checkout upsells are more important and more powerful than post-checkout upsells because they are still in the midst of buying your actual product, right? They're still kind of tailored to go forward through that guided process into your funnel. So I wish I had pre-checkout and post-checkout upsells set in hand, especially post-checkout upsells. I know post-checkout upsells do great on like niche and general niche stores, not so much on one product stores because there's only so many products you can have. And you probably already have pre-checkout upsell set up as well. So guys, if you have a general niche or niche store like I did in this case, definitely have post-checkout upsells as well. So again, that's just like a little short summary on what I learned and what I had done differently back then. With that being said, guys, I hope this video was informative to you guys. Really, 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 really hope you guys got some golden nuggets. Again, I'm really an open book. I'm really about transparency and clarity and really helping you guys as well. Please, 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 if you guys have any questions, thoughts, or concerns, drop them in the comments below. I always make sure to reply to each and every single one of you guys. I want every single one of you guys out to go there and smash the rest of 2020 and onwards, even if you guys are watching this next year or the year after.